Kerry on the JR, the Boss Man Show, here with former Kansas State head coach Lewis Preston, and he's an agent. Coach Preston, how life up there for you guys, man, up there, up North Cobbway, man?
Life up here is good. Can't complain right now. As we talked about earlier, you know, you got all the stuff going on in the NBA in light of everything today. So just kind of just taking it all in and seeing how we can get better as a society right now.
Most definitely, Coach Preston. I want to really talk about your journey because you was coaching at Kansas State and then you transitioned into the private world outside of coaching, and now you're an agent. So talk about that journey from how one journey stopped when coaching Kansas State to where you're at today, Coach. I think it's a great transition going from the floor to being an agent. And like, how have you done it? So let's talk to the listeners about that, Coach, if you don't mind.
The first thing in regards to that, JB, was, you know, I coached for 17 years, had a great coaching career, very fortunate to work with, I think when it's all said and done, you know, two Hall of Fame coaches and Mike Bray, worked with him for 6 years at Notre Dame, worked with Billy Donovan, was fortunate enough to be a part of that second national championship squad at Florida. And then, you know, from Notre Dame to Florida, then to Penn State. But before all that, I got started at Coastal Carolina with Pete Strickland, who was also my college assistant coach. So having a chance to have that type of a career, then becoming a head coach at Kennesaw State, not working out the way that I wanted it for 3 years. And then I actually stepped away from the game completely for about 2 or 3 years, went out into corporate America. And now I work with the BDS agency with Brian Stanchak on the men's side. I've been doing that now for about 2.5 years, representing college coaches. The main reason why I decided to do that was to help coaches not make the same mistakes that I made and kind of be that 30,000-foot view, overall objective view, have an experience in coaching, and then making sure that they're doing everything that they need to do to be the best coaches they can be, not only on and off the court, but also within the community and within society.
Most definitely, Coach, because having somebody who's been in those shoes to be able to represent them, we're dealing with ADs, booster clubs, all the people that deal with to get a contract done. I'm telling you, having somebody who's been in that fray and knows is very crucial, Coach. And I think that's a great thing. And because, you know, I know a lot of coaches in the business, of course, as you know, and knowing somehow how the deals come around, how they're structured, and they can get tricky and they try to run game on these guys. But having a guy like you, who knows the game, to represent them, they can save them some mistakes and sign some bad deals and get them messed up down the road or have the contracts terminated before they want to. You know, so that's great how you can be there to represent those guys out there, Coach.
Yeah, I think one of the main things right now is like everybody's trying to figure out this whole COVID piece, and you're starting to see this with contract extensions and things of that nature, how to try to navigate that. So, you know, I think during these times, especially when there's some financial uncertainty, especially at the collegiate level, how to navigate those murky waters, but also at the same time, making sure that you don't ruin a long-term relationship and knowing that, once again, as my mom and dad would always say, tough times don't last, tough people do.
Yes,
so
yes,
this
indeed.
Is one of those tough times. We got to figure out how to get through it.
Most definitely. And, you know, I noticed this carousel this time around was very light, you know, and I was happy with that because, you know, a lot of guys didn't lose their jobs. Because the carousel is usually about between 50 and 60 jobs, but they open up only in a given year in college basketball. This year, maybe like 25, 26, 27, which I'm happy for. So I feel like COVID gave some guys an opportunity because, you know, this was our new coach, that sometimes ADs and presidents get very impatient. You know, you give a guy a total rebuild job, you only give him 2 years, 3 years to get it done, and he needs to build his own program, correct errors from the last staff, and build it up. And year three, everyone as much you want to win, they firing a guy. So, like, you know, when you're trying to structure a deal, I'm assuming you try to get some protection, allow a guy to actually to build his program out the right way, not rush him 2 or 3 years, he's out of there. And we're doing the same thing over and over again.
Yeah, I mean, I think one of the main things in regards to that is if you're starting to really pay attention to collegiate athletics, a lot of times you're not able to go through a cycle of recruiting within that four-year span before there's changes made. If you're successful, most of the time you're able to move up in the coaching ranks to get a power seven, hopefully a power five job. If not, if you're on the other side of it and you're being terminated, it's making sure that you do what's best to not only protect yourself in the short term, but also the long term. I think for us, I think one of the things we've been fortunate is having a young man that I think is going to be a star in the coaching business, a young man, Marlon Sears, who actually just this past offseason, he's the new head coach at Amherst up in the Northeast, up outside of Boston. And I think one of the things that's amazing about that is building those relationships, mm-hmm. but also at the same time, you got to control your controllables the best way you know how. And I think what COVID's done, hopefully, to a lot of coaches is to get reconnected, not only with their teams and with their staffs, but also getting reconnected with their families as well, because I think that's very important as you continue to navigate through these times. Because as we've seen today, you've got certain things going on right now that I think these are going to have longer term effects as opposed to short term effects.
Yes, indeed, Coach. And like you kind of alluded to with the Milwaukee Bucks and the Orlando Magic, Buckeyes Lays game, and now the Thunder and the Rockets are not going to play. And we'll see what the Lakers and the Blazers are going to do. But it's time, Coach. You know, like I've pretty much used my show since June, Coach, for the greater good of our people, because I'm 33 years old. So I understand, you know, what can happen to a young man in college, to somebody older than me, because, you know, I live in it. You know, my parents grew up in the civil rights era. My parents are 69 and 79 years old. So my parents lived it. No, I'm the first one in my family to be born for rights, first thing was the Voting Rights Act, Fair Housing Act, civil rights. I'm the first one to be born, and that's 87. My parents weren't born with full rights when they was born. So it's a new day, Coach, and I feel like I've used my show for good to help affect the Atlanta community and beyond via the World Wide Web and the podcast world and the digital world, because the message is clear. It's time for a change, Coach.
Right, and if you've paid attention, I do not think there's been an NBA coach who's been as involved as Lloyd Pierce from the Hawks. Mm-hmm. In regards to social injustice and social change and being involved in the Atlanta community during the protests. I think one of the things about the NBA that they do a great job of is that they have come together collectively and voiced their opinion and voiced and continued to put it out in the forefront, because I think right now there is there's a lot of people behind the scenes that want to try to get back to some semblance of normalcy, mm-hmm. and to try to create some distractions to get away from what the message is. And I just going to continue to go back and say this. We got to keep making the main thing the main thing. And the social injustice that's going on, just watching everything just in our country right now, it is something that's eye-opening to me, being the father of two daughters, you know, living in Northwest Georgia, live in a great community. I'm not going to take anything away from the Cobb County community. I think it's one of the best communities in the state to live in. But also at the same time, you know, you're 33, I'm 49. And, you know, you just don't know on certain things what could happen. So we got to make sure that we are aware of that, and we continue to educate. Here's the four words I keep talking about all the time through this, and we talk to our clients about this as well. You've got to communicate, you have to educate, you have to empower, right? And then once you empower, you have to go out and continue to have empathy and compassion as we continue to learn, to grow, and continue to be a part of the change that we want to see in this world.
And, Coach, you know, I had never felt this way like I feel after George Floyd, Coach. And I decided, hey, I have a show with a platform that ranges deep. I need to use my voice for good. And, you know, Coach, I'll be honest with you. Now, I'm just going to say it on the air here. I've lost 4 sponsors. I've been talking about social issues, racial issues. I lost 4 sponsors. I don't care about it because I'm doing this for the good. That shows me about them and where they stand. So, long time about the Atlanta Hawks, the Atlanta Braves, and the Falcons, it's all good. Let's talk about me as a black man, it's a problem. So, that shows me where they stand. So, Coach, I feel like, you know, I've lived it. Had to be on Medicaid. I've had to be on food stamps. I've had to not have access to health care. All these issues that are in the forefront, I've lived them. So I'm going to speak on them. And, you know, now it's about, Coach, to my mind, right v. wrong. It's not right versus left. It's right versus wrong. You want to be the right side of history? Wrong side of history. Are you for the people or are you not? So that's where I'm with it, Coach. I feel like it's time for us to be real about it. If we want equality in America, we gotta be about it with our actions, not just our words, or just thoughts and prayers, and move on with our day.
Right. And JB, as you talk about that, even from a deeper perspective, at the end of the day, we're both black men. And if you've looked at the statistics, it hasn't been very favorable, you know, but we're also in a day and age and era that where social media is probably at its all-time high.
Mm-hmm.
So with that, there's a variety of different platforms. I mean, you see what's going on with the NBA, with the equality shirts, with the different things they're doing in the bubble. I think what Chris Paul is doing with the different HBCU shoes that he's wearing every game, you know, how players have shown a united front in their post-game interviews, coaches in their post-game interviews, you know, talking about the different things that's going on in America. We have to get to the point where we have to have the uncomfortable conversations.
Yes.
And I will go back and say this. I'm willing to be reasonable as opposed to rational with this. And what I mean by that is when you have rational thinking, you try to find people that follow or believe in what you believe and you go off in your group. When you talk about reasonable, you're willing to be wrong, right?
Mm-hmm.
But willing to be wrong knowing what you believe in, but once again, it comes to having the uncomfortable conversation. If you want to try to run away from this situation, it's going to eventually catch up to you. And I don't care if you are a Power 5 athletic director. I don't care if you are a Power 5, Power 7 college president or senior administrator. I don't care if you are a coach, assistant coach, support staff, players. You have to have these conversations. And we're seeing something right now that is so unprecedented that, and I'm talking about with COVID and then with everything else going on, it's almost like a perfect storm of events.
Most definitely. Where
you have to talk, all right? Because if you do not communicate now, once again, I'll say it and I'll say it 1,000 times, it's going to come back to haunt you later on. Because here's what I tell my coaches. How in the world can I, as a coach, during this time, not have these conversations with you, but then at a very critical point, I blow the whistle and I'm going to say I demand 100% of you. How can I demand 100% of you on and off the court when I didn't give you 100% of me?
Most definitely.
When you need a certain questions answered, that right there, you know, and I don't even coach anymore. And I've laid awake at night about that because once again, I'm a father, I'm a husband, I'm a brother, I'm an uncle, a cousin, you know? So, I mean, how can you do that? This is something that's in my mind is very hard to, you know, compartmentalize. I think you have to meet this head on and be willing once again. And I'm going to say it again. Now I'll say it until, you know, I go hoarse. You have to have the uncomfortable conversations.
You got that right, Coach. And, you know, that's what I've been trying to stress to my white friends. He's like, look, it's time to talk about this. You can't run from it no more. You can't hide behind, you know, the Bible or God. This is right and wrong. Now, if you feel about that, I'm pretty sure Jesus will be on the side of the protesters. If you're really about that, right? If you're about that life, you tell me you are. You can't hide behind policies, how I was raised. It's right and wrong. It's time to evolve. You know, I'm just going to say it. Conservative means to keep the same, to conserve, to preserve what it used to be. It's where it's time to progress, not regress. You know, Coach, I said it on my show, and I've offended some of the listeners by saying it, but it's just, Coach, I'm at a point, man. I'm doing this for my father, my mother, who are of age now, I've aged out and can't talk anymore. But I have a platform. As their son, who two parents who grew up, who was alive when Martin Luther King got assassinated and told me how it was now he got killed in Memphis that in 68. They both told me how it was. So I have stories for days from my parents who grew up in this area who can talk to me about how it was. So I feel, Coach, like I've been called now. I have a calling to use my sports platform and what's been given to me by the grace of God and my talents, but for a different cause. Now, still doing what I do for a living, Coach, which is cover sports, but also give people the life and the real, how it really is as being a black man in America, and how we make this change today and get uncomfortable to make the systemic change happen.
Right. And I will go back and I will say this as well. I think these are emotional times. Okay. We have to be strategic with the emotion versus logic. And what I mean by that is we all can logically say George Floyd was murdered. I've yet to see a person say that he was not murdered, right? Mm-hmm. So how do we move on from that and not move on to forget about it, but to move on to make sure it doesn't happen again? Now, I have former buddies that I play basketball with that are police officers, right? And in talking to them, they give me a much different perspective, right? But they also give me the perspective of being a black man who's also a police officer. So those things I do take into consideration. And that's the reason why, as I'm speaking right now, once you take the emotion out and you just think logically about this, and I take, you know, I this to me is not about politics. This is just about right and wrong.
Most right? definitely.
You know, and what we're trying to do is teach, you know, the next generation, the Gen Z generation behind us, you know, right from wrong. And that we've seen a lot of wrong that's happened. We've seen a lot of right that's happened during this time too. Because I think with times like this, there's great opportunity, right, to make sure that we don't have history repeat itself. And I think we're living through a form of history that's repeating, and hopefully it doesn't happen like this again in either one of our lifetimes.
Yes, indeed, Coach. You know, I can say when I see my little cousins who are 5, 4, and 2 years old, they so innocent and just don't understand what the world they're in. You know, I say, you know, I wish I had their innocent minds. But I don't sleep well sometimes thinking about, you know, how can I protect them? How can I make sure they're okay, you know, because they are three young little black boys who are growing up in Stockbridge, Georgia, not really knowing at their age what's going on around them. But I see it every day. I try to also tell my cousin, you have to talk to him about this. You can't run from him. He doesn't want to. He's scared to kind of think about it because those are his three boys. But you have to prepare yourself as a parent and eventually prepare them for that talk you have to give them. That, you know, so they can be ready for it. I'm trying to prepare his mind right now, Coach, because it's very key. We have I live in North Henry County here. So we are in great parts of town, great communities. But reality is, if we go a little bit farther out, this is Georgia. You know, it's just the real Georgia, you know. So we have to be prepared for that as well. So I try to tell my cousin, we have to always have our stuff out on the dashboard there. Don't make any sudden movements. Carry yourself a certain way so we can always, hey, don't be a threat. Don't present yourself a threat. Because if you're not a threat, you can also get killed sometimes. But try to listen all things you can to where it can go sideways. And don't try to win a traffic stop in the streets. That'll never happen. You got to beat them in court if you make it to court. So I was trying to teach my cousins and teach my listeners these concepts, Coach. I'm trying to get us to be protected down the road and save us from a bad outcome if we possibly can.
And I think with that also, we have to, I keep going back to the word educate, and we have to empower. And I think there has to be a level of empathy and compassion in regards to all of this. Mm-hmm. I go back and I think about this all the time. As much as possible, I try to take the emotion out of it, because I would not want to work in a job to where I was paid on the emotions of what my boss or supervisor or somebody was going through on a day in and day out basis, right? Mm-hmm. So I think we have to take, you know, to an extent, the emotion out of it, but it's also an emotionally charged time, because we keep seeing this stuff that's happening and we're like, when is it going to stop? And I don't have an answer to that. And going back to something I said earlier, when you're talking to coaches and you're saying, you know, talking about your white friends having these conversations, I think these conversations to me cross all color lines, because with it, there's a level of vulnerability you have. This might be one of the first times that as a leader, it's okay to say, I don't understand. You know, I don't understand what's going on with this right now. But, you know, if I'm talking to an individual student athlete, if I'm talking to somebody, you know, on my staff, if I'm talking to somebody within the athletics department, maybe you have somebody in your family that's going through it or is going through it. Help me to better understand it. How can I better educate my team through this? What are some examples, you know, historically that we've seen in regards to this? Because now, these aren't interesting times. These are horrifying times.
Most definitely.
We have to come to some type of, I'm trying to find the right word here. We have to come to a mutual level of respect for human life at the end of the day.
Most definitely.
A mutual respect of human life. Like, I do not walk out of here, out of my house, you know, I don't carry guns. I respect people that, you know, want to carry guns and do it. I don't walk out of my house with the intention of trying to do harm. I walk out of my house every day with the intention to try to bring some good into the world the best way I know how. Sometimes it's not for everybody. You know, sometimes people are just in a different place. But I think another important thing we have to do is meet people where they are and then try to help elevate from that, you know, particular spot of where they are. Once again, we can lead people to, you know, you can lead a horse to water, but you can't make him drink. Sometimes you can give all that you can, and then some people just don't want to accept it. And with that, you got to have the intelligence and the wherewithal to know when to move on to the next one. Because there's always, to me, going to be a next one out there. It's what I loved about coaching. There's always a next one that you can go out and have the opportunity to help change their life and impact their life and help to watch that light bulb come on.
Now, Coach, I know you've been out of the game for a few years here. Do you ever forget the urge to want to get back into coaching? Or do you feel like that life has passed you by, so you don't want to get back in ever?
The life has never really passed me by. I've stayed involved with basketball, whether it's doing some different things with the Hawks Naismith Classics or with Marcus Burnett and SUV TV. Was doing some stuff with the Georgia Hoop Circle, contributing there. I contribute to a variety of different things in regards to basketball. I love the game of basketball. It afforded me the opportunity to get a college education. It afforded me the opportunity to travel the world. It afforded me the opportunity to impact young men's lives. I met my wife through basketball. My two daughters were born when I was a basketball coach. So basketball has had a very positive impact on my life. So, you know, I'm very strategic now in how I use basketball, because at the end of the day, always in different talks, did you use the basketball or did the basketball use you? And hopefully it's you use the game of basketball to take you to those next levels in life as you transition out of that sport to whatever you want to do next, whether it's broadcasting, whether it's coaching, whether it's politics or whatever, you know, field or platform you want to go or use.
Now, Coach, you know, a lot of MVPs of being a coach is the coaches' wives. So, tell us about how your wife supported you and your daughter supported you, because I know that's really the untold story of a coach, is how the wife holds down the home while the coach is out recruiting, traveling, you know, game planning. You know, let's talk about how important a coach's wife is to the coach being successful as well.
I always tell people that a coach's wife is and that's the right way to put it. They're the real MVP, because, you know, we get to hide behind four walls when things aren't going well. And I can walk in my office at 6 a.m. and don't come out till 11 at night. I can control that. But, you know, they're the ones that have to take the kids to school. They're the ones that have to go to the grocery store, you know, historically. I think we've evolved to a better point now to where as men, we're more involved in regards to those duties, especially during COVID. But, you know, they hear more of the rumblings than you do. And then another part as coaches, you know, we kind of tune that out for the most part, knowing that part of signing that contract is, you know, there's going to be some Monday morning quarterbacks, some armchair quarterbacks that all have the answers. But they're also the same ones that are never willing to put themselves on that sideline for 40 minutes and see what it's really like to try to control an environment. So,
yeah, because I tell you what, you know, I can only imagine how coaches and wives have to deal with all the ups and downs, and you come home mad after a tough loss on the road or a trip, and just having the support of your kids and your wife to come to kind of make you forget about it for a few minutes about what just happened. Because so having that support system in the home, man, is so important. And I admire coaches and wives and what they deal with and how they keep the home stable and steady while the coach tries to make it right on the court for his program and his young men.
No, and not only are they basically, in a sense, kind of like the moms to the players that you bring into your program, but they also are the mother to your children. You know, they carry on a lot of responsibilities that I think are not highlighted the way that they need to be highlighted when you start thinking about a coach, whether they're successful or not. It's just a lot of the a lot of the responsibilities that a wife takes on, they kind of take on your identity as well. So, you know, as much as we talk about, hey, coach, are you okay? I don't think we talk enough about, you know, are our wives okay? Are our children okay? You know, because, I mean, I have a 17-year-old and a 15-year-old. Those can be some very interesting times in young people's lives that where they – there's a lot of stuff thrown at them.
Yes, indeed.
When you have a parent that's a public figure, a lot more stuff can be thrown at you.
You got that right. And, you know, Coach, you know what's a blessing about it, you know, is that, hey, you're impacting young men's lives. So let's talk about that part of the equation of coaching, impacting a young man's life, helping him become a great husband, father, worker, whatever, after that ball gets to drop, and using the basketball, use them for better. So let's talk about helping these young men that you've coached over the years grow into being, you know, great men in a society as they are right now.
I think one of the main things that I enjoyed about coaching was the relationships. You know, we always put a game plan together on how we were going to develop them on and off the court. But, you know, the main goal was to make sure that they would be productive men in society in some way, shape, or form. I've always felt that one of the greatest compliments you could ever receive is when a player, you know, lets you know, hey, you're getting married, get a wedding invitation. You're actually in a player or assistant coach's wedding, baby announcements, things of that nature. I think those things resonate because we all talk about the 2 to 3 to 4 years, but you really want it to be a 40 to 50 year relationship. And that to me is the main reason I feel like a majority of coaches coach, especially within my age group. I think another thing that we have to look at now is how are we preparing, you know, our future generation of young people that are players, you know, in regards to those next steps. How are we helping them? If we haven't learned anything from society, you have to be you have to understand the value of change, you know, because if you don't change, you're going to become obsolete. And we're always evolving as a society, whether we want to admit it or not. So hopefully we're evolving in the positives and not, you know, evolving in a negative way.
Now, Coach, this is one question that my listeners wanted me to ask you. I want your perspective on this. Coach, what's the difference between when you're working as an assistant coach vis-a-vis being a head coach? So if you can break down for my listeners the difference between when you're an assistant and then when you actually become a head coach, how responsibilities are divvied up based on in each role there?
I'll keep it very simple. As an assistant coach, I made suggestions. As a head coach, I made decisions.
Those definitely.
Two words, suggestions versus decisions. If it's a good decision, you look like a genius. If it's a bad decision, you're going to take the brunt of the hit. You know, I always tell people the common denominator between, you know, coaches. I mean, we have records, you know, and whether we like it or not, you know, some people say your record says who you are, you know, as a coach and everything. And sometimes you don't understand all those circumstances to go into it. But the main thing is definitely the suggestions part versus the decisions. I think when you start to put your staff, I think it's the most important thing you can do as a head coach is have the right staff. And in having that right staff to be able to delegate the responsibilities to where, as you're taking on other responsibilities within your program, whether it is speaking to the Kiwanis Club or the Rotary Clubs and things of that nature, that everything on the practice floor, in the film room, study hall, class checks, that all those things are still being done and you don't miss a beat.
Oh, definitely. I tell you, I described it as like being a CEO of an organization. That's how I was describing it to my listeners. But they wanted me to ask you because you are a coach. So ask him that question. I said, I'll ask him for you guys because I'll give you what you want. And you gave it to him simply as you could. Just the same as a co-host radio show. Suggest versus decision. Like I'm on the side of what I cover and I don't cover. I might take a suggestion, but I'm going to do what I want to do. You know, so I think you laid it out so perfectly right there. Coach, because I'm like, that's basically how it is.
Right. Well, here's the interesting part right now, JB. 10, 15 years ago, if you really paid attention to college athletics, a lot of your ADs were former coaches. Mm-hmm. You know, when you start to look at college athletics now, especially at your Power 5, Power 7 levels, a lot of these ADs or development. They know how to raise money. They're not necessarily former coaches. They study sports. They didn't necessarily play them. So that's where you're starting to get more the business mindset of the CEO terminology and things of that nature. And then a lot of that also has to go back to when we had conference realignment and the money started to get really big. Felt like you needed more business people as opposed to, once again, having those former coaches. And I think with that, you've had somewhat of a disconnect between your administrators that are more money people as opposed to understanding, you know, what coaches go through. So, and I think that's something that as we continue to evolve, you know, hopefully to get back to that side of having coaches, having athletic directors and administrators that have experience with that respective sport, as opposed to just watching it and then trying to make those decisions without knowing what a coach really goes through those different seasons.
Got two more for you, Coach. And first one is about the money as well, Coach. A lot of non-conference schedules for the lower major schools, lower mid-major schools are in jeopardy because of COVID, you know. So, And you coach at Kennesaw State, so you might have to raise money, play guarantee games and money games. If those games are not available to fund athletic departments and fund the non-revenue sports, how are these schools going to survive sports-wise through COVID if there's no non-conference games for men's basketball, women's basketball, and also football? Because I fear for those universities who depend on those opportunities to make money for the university, and now with COVID, they might not have the opportunity to do that now. So how do you feel about that? How's it going to shake out now with those schools having to be in this precarious predicament right now where the money might not be committed this year to fund everything?
I mean, you know, it is a tumultuous time right now because you have decision makers or decisions that have to be made if those dollars are not able, you know, to be, you know, found through playing your guarantee games and you know, I think it's above 50-50 whether you'll see college football or not this year, which takes a huge hit in regards to your athletic budgets and things of that nature. And if you've really been paying attention, you're starting to see athletic departments talk about furloughs. I just saw that the other day with Clemson talking about furloughs. And that word right there, or layoffs, things of that nature. So it's very concerning right now, and hopefully we can correct this and understand that, you know, this is an unprecedented time, but there were things along these same lines that happened back in 2008 with the financial crisis. And once again, hopefully we can learn better moving forward in regards to that.
That's what I got for you, Coach. I wanted to ask you about Coach Peel, Randy Peel. He's the guy who brought us together. Yeah. He told me to reach out to you because you was a great guy. We both here in the Atlanta area, so he wanted to make a point that we connected. So tell us about Randy Peel, how you know him, what he's meant to you in your career, and stories you have about Coach Peel and what his love for basketball.
You know what? Coach Peel is one of the hardest working coaches I've ever been around. What I love about him is what you see is what you get. You know, I grew up, you talk about your parents grew up in the civil rights era, mine did too. My dad was a crane operator and a custodian. So honest days work for honest days pay, you know. And when you talk about Randy Peel, that's what you see. Loves giving back and pouring back into young people. Has stories for days. I love going back and talking to the people that have come before me to help pave the way and talk about how they had to adjust to how times have changed. I mean, you think about Randy, I mean, he started in this business when there was no rules, to where you have rules. You know, I mean, you used to be gone. I remember when I first got into coaching 17 years ago, we'd be gone literally the whole month of July recruiting, you know. And so you pack up bags and, you know, you have a Nike bag packed, you know, loaded to the top. Like, all right, I got to get – trying to figure out how to get 10 changes of clothes in here. And then, you know, you either using the hotel wash machine or whatever. And, I mean, it's amazing how it's changed. But the game's still the same because you got to figure out how to put that ball in the basket one more time than the opponent does.
Most definitely. Most definitely. But Coach Press, this has been an honor to talk to you. It's been great. It's covered a lot of ground here today with you. We got to do this again real soon. And I hope to come up there and see you guys real soon. We get to have some lunch one day when it's safe around, I guess. You know, we're going to have lunch somewhere around here one of these good days here, Coach.
And you know what? You come up to this area, I'll take you to a good spot. And then when I come down to Henry County, you take me to a good spot down there. We'll even it out.
Yes, indeed. Coach, hey, Coach, thank you for your time. It was a pleasure, man.
JB, the honor was all mine, and I look forward to talking to you again soon.
All right, Lewis Preston on the Boss Man Show.
Sally Beauty's new all-in-one hair color kits make it easy to color your hair at home. Get everything you need to color for beautifully radiant results. Loved by professionals, open to everyone. Sally Beauty.
All right, you folks, back here on the Boss Man Show. Hill Sacred Hearts basketball coach, Coach Anthony Latina with me. Coach Latina, how are you and your family doing so far up there, man? I know it's been a rough time for us all, man, talked about off the air, man, but how have you and your family and your team been?
You know, it's certainly been different. There's been some challenges. You know, I try to be a person of gratitude and appreciation, so I know that me and personally and my family and even our program have it better than most people. So I always try to keep that perspective in mind and come from a place of gratitude because I am very blessed. My family is very blessed. Our program is very blessed. Our school is doing great. So those are all things that are not the case for a lot of people in this country right now. So with that being said, for me to complain, I would feel very it wouldn't be right. So kids are doing great. I feel bad. You know, they're hopefully going back to school in like a hybrid model in the next couple of weeks. My son's going to be a senior and my daughter's going to be, well, I could say our son, my wife and I's son, and our daughter is going to be, she's going to be a sophomore. He's going to be a senior. So they're both athletes. We're hoping that they are allowed to play and hopefully things get better. So, but again, I try to, like I said, come from a place of gratitude because I know I'm very blessed. So we'll get through this. And I think there's been some positive. I've been able to spend a little more time with my family than normal. Normally, I'm traveling in the summer a little more. So that's been pretty cool. I think from a relationship with my children and my wife, there's been some added benefits that I've been very fortunate to be able to experience. I'm excited to be talking to you from my office, though. The last couple of weeks I've been coming into the office, but there was a stretch there was I was only in our office for one or two times in four or five months. Yeah, wow. So it's great to be back.
Yeah, Coach.
I like work.
Hey, the same here. You know, for me, Coach, it's been weird to be doing Zoom interviews now, but I like it because I get to see you guys now rather than the phone. So it's kind of been that new wrinkle. It's kind of been good to see people now rather than just be on the phone. So working from home now, getting to spend time with my dad, who's turns 80 years old today. So getting to spend time with my dad.
Happy birthday to your father. That's great. I hope you get to spend some time with him.
Yeah, so the blessing of the pandemic is I spent time with my dad, man, because, you know, he's up in age now. Now, I'm 33, but he's up in age, so getting to spend that quality time with him, I don't usually get to spend with him, so it's been great. He was doing the Atlanta Braves in the offseason from the Hawks, so now I'm doing it to spend time with Father Pops and enjoy him, Coach, so I'm blessed as well, man.
That's awesome. I wish him a happy birthday. I can relate. My father's 87, so every day is a blessing, you know?
Most definitely. Now, Coach, you know, it's funny. The NBA stopped on my birthday, March 11th. And so when everything went down, where were you and your team at? And how did you and your staff kind of map out what to do with your players after everything got canceled and everything was starting to shut down in March there around my birthday there?
Well, we were actually still scheduled to play in a postseason tournament. So, obviously, that was a little bit of a letdown for our guys because we had a special season. But, you know, we understood and everyone understood the situation. And at the time, nobody knew anything, you know, nobody knew, you know, obviously this has been a serious thing, but I think at the time, you know, there was a serious concern that, you know, people were just going to be, you know, that as bad as it's been, I think the expectation was that it was even worse than this.
Yeah.
That was my sense of it. And I think that was the sense of certainly people on our team and our campus. So I don't think not playing, although disappointing, was not that big of a deal. But, you know, and then we just wanted to make sure, you know, our school sent everyone home. So we wanted to make sure our guys were doing well. You know, we were in a little bit of a transition because, you know, we had a few seniors. And then, of course, as college basketball works, you know, they're, you know, when you have some success, there's some at our level, there's some departures, which, you know, we were dealing with. So we were just trying to make sure that everybody was in a good place mentally, that everyone was safe and healthy, and really just try to support our guys. And then once we had to deal with some of the transfers, which we expected, you know, which is, again, part of the deal at this level, we then had to come up with a game plan of, all right, we're going to have to recruit some guys. And so recruiting was a big focus of ours while my staff and I were all working remotely. So, you know, we were able to sign a few international players through some contacts of ours that we respect and trust. And we were also able to sign a couple of players that we had seen. So, you know, we're going to have 9 new players on our roster of a roster of 15. So, and 10 new players that didn't play last year, you know, someone else sat out. So we're a whole new team. And once we got the roster situated, now it was a question of trying to get to know each other remotely, you know.
Most definitely.
There's a lot of our guys. I mean, we had 10 new guys. Out of the 10, 5 or 6 of those guys had never met any other player on our team face-to-face because they didn't go through the traditional recruiting process of an official visit and those kind of things. So
most definitely.
It was really, really an interesting, unique time. You know, I've been coaching for 25 years and experienced nothing like that. I mean, even the recruiting process, doing virtual virtual Zoom tours of campus and, you know, things of that nature were it was great. I mean, I feel like I learned a lot. You know, that's the interesting thing. You know, there's been a lot of negatives, way more negatives than positive, but there have been some positives in terms of use of technology, Zoom. One of the things I with my kids, now my kids are older, again, one's going to be a senior, one's going to be a sophomore, my own children, is we should never have a snow day ever again. Now, in the Northeast, that's something you deal with all the time.
Obviously, I'm scared Atlanta, of snow, Coach. I'm scared of snow. Atlanta, snow shuts us down, man. Inch, we're done here.
But my thing is this. We should never have a snow day ever again. Just if it's snowing,
Zoom it,
no question. So this way, in terms of, you know, in having younger kids at the time, we know when they're going to end. We can plan for the summer programs, things of that nature. So I thought that was a positive. And then my, you know, be able to, by use of technology and Zoom and being able to have some face-to-face contact with friends that are at a distance. I thought, obviously, we had FaceTime, but you become more comfortable with this. So that's kind of what we've been doing. And so now, you know, some of our players have moved in. A few more are going to move in today. A few more, everyone will be in by Saturday. And we're really excited. You know, it was college is going to look very different. Well, everything's going to look different, but you know, our university is a great place and we're super committed to having the students here. Obviously, we're taking some measures to make sure everyone stays safe. It's not the normal college experience. I've really tried to preach to not only myself, but our players and our coaches is that we're going to have to be very flexible. Mm-hmm. We have to be patient. You know, I'm very organized. Some people would call me obsessive compulsive. A matter of fact, I probably have an obsessive compulsive disorder that I've never been diagnosed with, but I'm going to have to be more flexible in terms of changing schedules. That's just going to be a reality of our lives right now, even in our preparation. You know, normally by this time, it was funny, we had a meeting with our staff yesterday. Normally I have, by the middle of August, I have our whole schedule done. September, October, practice schedule, days off, game schedule, even we have a bulk of our recruiting days penciled in at this point. We don't even have we have 3 weeks in September scheduled and that's it because, you know, we're not sure we're going to start playing and mm-hmm. A lot of variables out there. So, you know, I think flexibility and patience, which is probably something you should always practice in your everyday life, is something we're really, really going to have to embrace. And that includes myself as well. So hopefully we're in that type of mindset and we can kind of function in that type of environment.
Now, Coach, I feel like this recruiting has changed forever now. So now with limited budgets, now you can just zoom a guy. Because I know at your level, at the mid-major level, sometimes the recruiting budget is not what a Power 5 or Power 7 school is, right? So it can save you money on the front end and the back end by zooming guys. So now no guy's out of reach now because of Zoom. Now the technology has made it better. So you can not have to be on the road so much. I'm late nights driving to see kids. Now you can zoom them and talk to them that way and get, just give them a zoom tour of the campus. And that way, I feel like recruiting now, coach, has changed forever now. For the better.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, I think your reach can be a little wider. I'm a little old school still that I think there's nothing like a face-to-face conversation. There's nothing like feeling a campus, touching a campus, you know, that interaction. So I do think there are going to be some changes. There's going to be some steps that you can, where you can really develop a relationship in a different way. And it's all going to come down to two is, you know, so much of recruiting is, well, what's our competition doing? You know, because if our competition at our level, obviously we're not recruiting against the Dukes and, you know, the ACC and the Big East and, you know, that type of thing. But if teams at our level, like the Northeast Conference and the America East and the MAC and, you know, the Patriot League are having kids on campus, then we're going to have to do that as well. So I think, but you're right. I think, with all the disruption and people are going to be much more careful with their money, you know, not only universities, institutions, and but just businesses in general. So I think, you know, you're going to have to be a little more creative, innovative, and just do the best you can. But I hope that the days of face-to-face interaction never go away, because I think part of me is like, that's what life is all about is getting to know someone, you know, shaking someone's hand and really looking them in the eye face to face. And you know, I hope that doesn't go away, but you're right. There's no question that there are different ways to certainly get to the end goal of, you know, because that's what recruiting is developing relationships, developing trust. So I think there are other ways to do that now. And we'll try to utilize them the best we can and do everything we can to get it. You know, everybody's still going to try to get advantage. Recruiting is about trying to get as much. We don't want a level playing field. We want to have all the advantages as people do. So we're going to do whatever it takes to try to put ourselves in the best position to get the best players that fit what we're looking for.
And, Coach, speaking of that, I know at your level you have to play those guarantee games. And I've seen some contracts, Coach, that I don't like what I see, what they say if it's no fans, it's this, or if it's fans, it's this. Having to raise money for university, raise money for the non-revenue sports, and we don't know if you're going to play non-con, because we don't know right now. That, to me, is scary for all college athletics because, like, hey, a lot of schools, I went to TSU, Tennessee State University. I know how small school life is. They need those guarantee games to survive for men's basketball, and football. I know that. A lot of schools that, like, they're smaller, they need that. So how do you feel about the possibility of not having those guarantee games to help fund university right now?
That is definitely a problem. There's no question. As a matter of fact, I was talking to our associate athletic director who's in charge of budgets, and she's the best. And we had a meeting, where are we with guarantees? I said, well, we don't know if we're going to play them, but yeah, that's a lot of revenue, you know, anywhere, you know, at schools our level, it can be anywhere from $150,000 to $450,000, you know? So I think the approach that certainly Sacred Heart University is taking, but I would say a lot is, we got to do whatever you got to do to get through this year. We know there's going to be a loss of revenue. You know, we have a couple different contracts out there where we're only going to get 50% of the guarantee if there are no fans, which, you know, probably looks like that's going to happen, and certainly first semester. But I actually think it's even going to be worse than that. I think, you know, certainly we have great leadership in men's basketball. The NCAA does. Dan Gavitt, I think, is well-respected, brilliant. So I think the biggest focus right now for everybody in Division I men's basketball is, let's do whatever we have to do to have a season. Mm-hmm. Because the NCAA tournament is where the real revenue is generated. And not only for men's basketball, but like you said, you know, I read this the other day, and I don't know if this is accurate, so don't quote me on this, but I think the NCAA men's basketball tournament brings in 90% of all the revenue the NCAA brings in. Mm-hmm. So the NCAA men's tournament pays for everything. You know, people talk about football, and football makes a ton of money for individual schools. Like Alabama football makes millions of dollars for the University of Alabama. Michigan football makes millions of dollars. But the NCAA men's basketball tournament, that pays for everything. That pays for the Northeast Conference budgets and the Mary, or I would say outside the Power Seven, you know, the Power Five in the Big East, and I don't know who the seventh is. I'm trying to think, or maybe the American.
The American.
Yeah. Outside of those, maybe those seven conferences, and you're throwing Gonzaga, the NCAA tournament funds all these other conferences, the other 25 or so conferences. So everybody understands that. And it's not just for men's basketball players. I mean, that tournament funds the tennis teams and the golf teams and all the other teams, which are, listen, like, those are important. You know who those are important to? The golfers and the tennis players and the, you know, whatever, the track athletes. You know, those are opportunities for young people that may not have opportunities. So I do think there is a sensitivity and understanding, like, hey, we have to do whatever we have to do, not only just for men's basketball, because men's basketball and football are going to be fine because they make money. It's for all the other sports.
Because,
you know, and I know the NCAA, you know, gets a lot of flack, and, you know, it may be rightfully so at times, but it does create a lot of opportunities for young people that would not be there. You know, all of our players are on a full scholarship. They don't pay a penny to go to school. Now, those of us that paid to go to school understand how unbelievable that is to go to school. You know, my wife put herself through college. She had to work 3 waitressing jobs on weekends to pay for herself to go through school. So when you can go to school for free, first of all, it creates so many opportunities. I mean, it can be life-changing. So we don't want those to go away. Those are opportunities for people that might not have otherwise had one. So I think the main focus, and again, everything is important and money is important, is to let's have some type of season so we can play an NCAA tournament so that the positive things that the NCAA does can continue. You know, that doesn't mean you don't reform and you don't make changes. Of course you do, and you always try to get better. But let's not, you know, the old saying, and I don't even know where this came from, but let's not throw out the baby with the bathwater here. Let's remember, like, there's a lot of positives that come from this.
Yes.
The revenue that's generated. Sometimes you're like, oh, the NCAA makes all this money. All this money goes back to the schools, goes back to the conferences, which goes back to the student athletes, which is a wonderful thing. You know, it's a wonderful thing. And so our biggest focus is we're going to do whatever is necessary to try to have a season of some sort so we can have an NCAA tournament. Let's find a way to make it happen. Let's make the sacrifices that need to be made to make that happen. I think most coaches are in that most basketball coaches are in that mindset, and then hope for the best. But again, I have the utmost confidence in not only Dan Gavitt, but also our NABC leadership, that we're going to do whatever it takes for the membership to make sure this happens and hope for the best. And again, at that point, we're going to have to be flexible. We're going to have to be super, super flexible. And you know, I think that's the way we got to go. And because, you know, we have no other options, you know, and I think the other thing too is, you know, we talked about what some of the positives of this is. I think all of us, myself included, not just coaches, but just in general, there's a lot of things that we take for granted that have taken for granted for so long.
It's yes.
And now we're like, wow, things can be changed. Things can change like that. Life can change like that. Boy, we had it pretty good. How many people would say, man, we would just love to get back to normal?
Yes.
You know, normal was pretty good for most of us. You know, I mean, and again, that doesn't mean it was perfect. And obviously a lot of things are going on in the world that are showing that life is far from perfect. But I do think I've always, and I don't know, you know, I probably learned this from my family who kind of came over here from Italy as immigrants that didn't speak any English. And I think I've always learned to try to have gratitude for the things that you have. Come from a place of humility and know that, you know, things, you always got to fight to make things better, but always try to come from that mindset, and because things can change and there's no guarantees. And so I'm really looking forward to trying to make this the best year possible for our team, our program, try to, you know, do some positive things for our guys, have a great experience, make some positive changes. We'll always keep in mind to try to make things better, but understand that, you know, if you're here on a full basketball scholarship at Sacred Heart University, which I think is a first-class, you know, institution, and these guys are going to get a first-class education, you know, we got to come from a, you know, from a place of gratitude. So I've used that word probably 50 times in the last.
No, but it's a great word. A great word, Coach. A great word.
You know, it was, the old saying, if we magnified our blessings as much as we magnified our disappointments, we'd all be a lot happier and we'd all be a lot more fulfilled. And so I'm really going to try to stress that not only for myself, my family, but my basketball family here as well. Let's magnify our blessings and let's make this work the best we can. And hopefully, you know, people a lot smarter than me can figure this out and make things a little safer from the medical side, a little safer for people in our communities, in society. And let's all try to come from that type of place. There was a great line I heard, you know, the other thing too is in this situation, I think sometimes people listen to respond to things. And I think one of the things that I've learned, and this is a line that I've heard multiple times in the last 6 months, is I think we need to start listening more to understand. You know, listen to people. Sometimes we're having a conversation and we're just listening, waiting for you to finish talking so I can respond rather than say, all right, what is someone else saying? Especially when it comes to important things in life, is let's try to listen to understand a little bit. And if we do that, I think things will improve.
Oh, and definitely.
That's what we're trying to do. But I really appreciate having a chance to actually talk to you and look at you. This is a little different interview than last time.
Yes.
But that's kind of where we're at right now.
And Coach, you know, since George Floyd and things have happened here in Georgia, Ray Sharp, Brooks, Breonna Taylor, and Ahmaud Arbery, I've decided to use my show to help in the community. And Coach, I feel like I never thought I'd be in activism, Coach. I never thought I would get involved in that, but I felt motivated to do so because I'm 33, have a platform that reaches from Chattanooga through Macon, 1.1 million listeners beyond the digital platform. So I can affect changing people. And, you know, being with the Atlanta Hawks and working around the Hawks players, I feel like I have a platform to give people a new perspective that, hey, we can do this together. My dad was a barber, Coach. So I've been dealing with people my whole life in the barber shop. You know, he's a barber. My mama's a psychologist. So from day one, I've done different backgrounds from day one. I can do anybody, like any background, right? So knowing that, I've said I'm going to still cover my sports, but also talk to people and make a positive change, because together, what's going on in the world, we're now talking about us coming together as one to find common ground, happy medium to just agree on these set of right and wrong principles to make things better for everybody generation after us going forward. Because my dad's 80 years old today. I'm 33. So we got two different generations apart, pretty much age-wise. So I'm looking down the road, and he grew up in an area where it was segregated Atlanta. He could cross railroad tracks after dark, right? So he's lived these things, and I'm living a little bit differently than him, but I want to make it better for those after me, Coach. So that's where I feel like, you know, this COVID gave me a chance, and things has happened where it's inspired me to use my platform for good and be better and help people be better going forward, Coach.
Oh, no question. I mean, you said that. You couldn't have said that any better. We all want the same things. Everyone wants to feel safe. Everyone wants to, you know, have an opportunity. I mean, all of us, this is the thing that I always try to stress to our guys. And I've been blessed to play basketball. I grew up in a city. I grew up in Hartford, which was a very diverse city. And the one thing I find is people are a lot more alike than they are different.
Yes.
We're all unique. But we're a lot more alike than we are different. And I think that doesn't mean we don't have different perspectives and different life experiences, because we certainly do. And again, you don't ignore those things and you don't pretend that they don't exist. Of course that you do. You try to make things better. But if we come from a place of, hey, we're a lot more alike, we probably want most of the same, the important things, like we want the same things. And I think you try to listen to understand, then things start getting better. I mean, these things happen on an individual level. I think, you know, as you know, relationships develop and people see different people and they say, wow, he's a great person and that person's a great person and this is not what I thought and that's not what I thought and stuff like that. I think things get better. So I'm a very optimistic person by nature, but I am super optimistic. I think when all this is over, coronavirus and a lot of the civil unrest, I think we're going to come out a lot better. I really believe that. I'm not one of these people that says, you know, things are getting worse. I don't believe that. I think things are going to get better. I think things are getting better. I think the fact that things can be discussed now more freely than they ever were is a positive, you know? And I think now the one thing that we need to do is, because sensitive topics are being discussed much more freely, I think the empathy and understanding has to increase with that.
Yes.
Because now we are going to talk about things now that we didn't maybe talk about 25 years when I first started coaching. And in doing that, we have to all, and this is an individual thing, and I think everybody has to do this individually, is, hey, listen to understand. Listen with empathy. Listen with humility. Know that you don't know. Great philosopher, I don't know if it was Socrates or Aristotle or Plato, one of them said, I know that I don't know. And that's why, where the wisdom is that you know you don't know everything. And that you can learn something. You know, one of the things I'm stressing to my players is you want to have a good day. There's three things you got to get better. You got to get better every day at three things. You got to become a better. You got to do three different areas. You got to get better. Your body, that's physical, whether it's a workout, whatever. Your mind, all right, or your reading, and your soul. And that's different to a lot of different people. If you got better in those three areas today, That's a heck of a day.
Yes,
you
know, indeed. Remember,
if you get better in 3 years, if you have exercised or worked out or whatever level you are, if you're a basketball player and you worked on your game or you push yourself, that's a good thing. If you read a book that maybe you wouldn't read or exercised your mind and then exercised your soul, which is, again, that's a tricky thing. You know, we're a Catholic university, so, you know, our easiest way to exercise soul is prayer. But there's other ways. Some people don't believe in God, which is fine. So maybe you meditate, or maybe you do something. Maybe you have a gratitude journal. But let's make sure we're getting better in those three areas every day. If people are committed to doing those three things, we'll be a healthier society. We'll be in a more educated society, and we will be a more tolerant society. And then things are really going to get better. But again, I'm optimistic, and I think this is, we're going to be better for this. All of this, I think most growth happens when you're uncomfortable.
Yes.
And a lot of us are very uncomfortable right now for a variety of reasons, whether it's your 80-year-old dad or my 87-year-old father not being able to, my dad goes to his club, his Italian club. He hasn't been there in 6 months. That, other than spending time with his family, that's his favorite thing to do. And he hasn't done that. And I have two older sisters, and I said, man, you know, when do we think it's safe to let him go to there? And I'm like, you got to understand, I've tried to, this is important to him. This was his thing. Mm-hmm. I know it's not important to you guys think it's silly, but it's important to him. So I think that we're all making our own sacrifices in our own way. And, but just to understand that we're all going through things. And I think a lot of what's happening is also that because so many difficult things are happening, that people are struggling with that. Whether it's being cooped up in the house or whether it's, you know, you just got pushed. So I think doing those things will help. I'm really excited about it, to have the opportunity, again, like you said, your platform, and to use whatever platform you have to try to make things better. You know, I always say, are you making things better or are you making things worse? Because you're doing one or the other. I always tell that to our players. Are you guys making us a better, are you making us a better team or a worse team? Are you making things better out here or worse? And if you can't say definitely better, then you got to reevaluate how you're approaching this thing here. So that's what we're going to try to do. I'm sure we'll make a lot of mistakes, all of us. But if we come from the right, I think the right intentions and the right place, and come from, a, you know, I think things will get better, and I really look forward to it, and I think sports is a great way, because yes. You know, people come from so many different areas. You know, they, you know, sports is the ultimate meritocracy. Like, if you can play, you can play. If you can't play, you can't play. It don't matter. Anything else don't matter. So I think, you know, we're going to try to do, you know, what we can in our little community to make things better. And maybe that spreads to other places. And that's what we're going to try to do. But it's been a difficult situation. We've had a lot of, like I said, uncomfortable, difficult conversations. But that's, you know, the more we're comfortable being uncomfortable, the more we're going to grow. The most growth happens in those times.
Yes. Yes. And coach, you know, for me, like, I can tell a story. 1994, I didn't meet my first white kid until 97. I was 7 years old, coach. That was from travel baseball. So sports taught me about another race, another background I wasn't exposed to until playing travel baseball. So you're so right. Sports brings us together, because I never would have met my friends, Kyle and Derek, the twins, who are my friends today, if I haven't played travel baseball with them, because I hadn't met any white kids until 7 years old, 94, which is wild, you know? So it's, you're so right. Sports is a great equalizer. It can bring us all from different backgrounds for one common goal as a team, to represent the name on the front, the name on the back, to win a game together.
No question. No doubt about it. So, no, it's, you know, so we just got to keep doing the right things and keep doing our best and, you know, be understanding as we can of people, know that people are going to make mistakes. Let's not bury somebody when they make a mistake, no matter who it is. You know what I mean? Let's try to, you know, that's the one thing I fear is people are going to make mistakes. So especially as we have more difficult conversations, things might be said that offend. So let's understand, hey, where you came from and you know, how do we correct this? And why did that bother you but not bother me? Because I don't understand why that's bothering you. I have no idea. But it really is. So tell me, maybe help me to understand that. So I'm really trying to encourage that my players, because there are certain things that my players say that really bother me. But they don't bother them. And I'm like, well, I'm trying to understand, how does that not bother you? You know, so I think there's that part of it. But again, I think when we all come back to, we're a lot more alike than we're a lot yes. more different. Then boy, you know, when you come from that place and that thought, you know, you're right. We all want to be fulfilled and we all want to be happy and we all want to have opportunity. And that those are universal. I don't care whether it's the United States of America or, you know, the most remote island on this in the world. I mean, that's what people want, and that's what people need, and that's where people thrive. So, you know, we got to all try to come to there, and it's not going to be easy, but it's worthwhile. You know what I mean?
Definitely.
And most things that are worthwhile aren't easy.
Oh, definitely. Well, Coach Latina, this has been great to catch up with you, man, and see you, man. We can have this great conversation, man, about life and just how we can make things better, man, and how Sacred Heart's going to be do their part, man. It's been enjoyable. We'll do this again real soon. We'll do another Zoom, Coach. I really enjoyed this, man.
I enjoyed it tremendously. You stay safe. Happy birthday to your father. Please, you know, have a great day with him. And anytime, I would love to speak to you. I really enjoyed our time.
Anytime, Coach. Hey, you be good, buddy. We'll do it again real soon, man.
All right, take care.
All right, see you, buddy.
How do you feel about your office? Is it just a space for your company, or is it a space to help you grow your company? From new HQs to satellite offices, with WeWork, you can find a space that works for you. Visit we.co/spacematters to learn more.
All right, folks, back in the Boss Man Show, friend of the show, Ryan Ritter, the coach of the Bethune-Cookman Wildcats. Coach, man, glad to see you again and glad to have you back. I hope you've been safe, buddy.
Man, it's great to see you. Great to be back. Always enjoy our conversations pre-season.
Yes, indeed. Well, Coach, I got to ask you, man. I kind of told you off the air about how the season stopped on my birthday for the NBA and on March 11th. So where were you guys in that situation? Was it the MEAC tournament probably? So how did you guys handle news when it came down, and of course getting kids back home and go from virtual learning to from being in class? So how's that for you and your team and your staff, man, that whole whirlwind and march around on my birthday there?
You know, that particular day was really, really tough for our program. We had six seniors, and we had a good regular season, but we really felt like we were playing our best basketball. You know, had won, I think, 6 out of 7 going into the tournament. And those six seniors had finally really come into their own, and we were eating pregame meal 3 hours before our first round game, and we're told that our season was coming to an end. So obviously the basketball side was really tough, but you know, those six guys that have put so much blood, sweat, and tears, that was tough to see their college career in that way, because so many questions they have at that time of, well, you know, coach, what do I have eligibility? Do I go get a job? Am I trying to play professionally? And you know, that can be overwhelming for a, you know, 21, 22 year old kid. So that particular day was tough on our program. You know, but since then, just really trying to help those guys transition into, you know, whatever their endeavors are professionally, whether it's basketball, job, parenting. And then also trying to regroup with the guys we got coming back. You know, obviously no face-to-face meetings. We're trying to stay as organized as we can and try to provide as much patience and flexibility. But at the end of the day, you know, the virus is in charge, and that's what we're trying to help guide our guys right now into to as much safely as we can.
I know a key person on your staff was academic advisor, because having kids going home and to be on their own devices, make sure their grades stay up, stay eligible to play with their grades, and had to be rough. I know you can look at on Blackboard what the guys are doing, but how was that trying to make sure the guys stayed on top of the academics when they were back home and kind of not knowing what's going on in the world around them?
Yeah, I mean, that's the toughest part, because, you know, we've got a great student athlete success team at our school, and we do have a very, very good academic advisor, but all of a sudden you have 15 guys that are now either all learning remotely, and some of them have not taken online classes before, some of them have. And so, you know, just the communication was really key, being able to provide that for each of our guys and having them have their own individual coaches where they're grouped into, you know, groups of three or four, and they're able to kind of connect with coaches on a daily basis, and then we're able to help relay that academic information. So, you know, we had a good spring. I think we've got a really good handle on this fall in terms of our academic situation. But, man, you're right. That position is so huge in college athletics.
And I know the parents are probably even talking to you more than ever now because of all the uncertainty. So how's the parent involvement been in getting closer to the parents again after you recruited the guys and the parents and you kind of reconnecting again is to kind of make sure that their young man is okay? So how's that been dealing with the parents here and all their concerns about the question with the virus and when the guys are coming back on campus and are you going to play? How's that process been?
Yeah, that is a great question. And that's actually you know, this year we've got 15 young men on our roster. We finally in year four been able to recruit some younger kids, some four-year transfers, some guys that, you know, we've been recruiting the last 2-3 years. So we've gotten a chance to really know their parents, their AAU coaches, their high school coaches. So that network around them has been really strong. So the communication with the parents, I've welcomed everything. Any question they have, I don't know the answers, but I will try to find them out for them. And I think just assuring them that we're doing everything safely and in their son's best interest has been key for us. You know, as of right now, you know, we're not even actually working our guys out. We're going through additional safety testing to make sure that we're putting these guys in the best position, one, academically, but then two is before we put them on a court, making sure we're doing everything we can to make sure they're as safe as they can be.
How's it in Florida? I know here in Georgia, it's been still kind of steadily high with the virus. So in your area in Daytona, how's it been? Is numbers coming down? Or do you think it'll be safe for the guys to come back on campus in the near future here where they feel safe and it's not before flu and cold season starts here real soon?
Yeah, you know, it depends on which day of the week you ask. You know, every time I start feeling like we're having a positive shift, you know, we'll have a potential cluster breakout or something happens, not necessarily on our campus. We've been fortunate so far. Our guys have been back for almost 2 weeks, and we've had very, very minimal COVID cases on campus. So we've done a great job protecting our students that way. But yeah, I mean, it really depends on the day you ask. I think we are, as of right now, showing progress, specifically in Volusia County, where is Daytona Beach, where Bethune Cookman is. But you know, as soon as I say that, you know, tomorrow can be a different day, and you know, we're doing our best on campus. I know that. I know our leaders, our president, our safety council has done a heck of a job of putting in parameters to make these guys feel and be as safe as they can.
And coach, having talked to your young men about being able to say no when they want to say yes, because you know, their guys are 18, 19, 20 years old. They want to go out. They want to go see their friends and go, maybe go to a party, but to make them, it's bigger than them right now. You can't do that because one little incident that you might think is innocent, that you could cause a whole outbreak of a whole team and then a whole department. So how have you guys stressed this to the young men that, hey, you might want to say yes, but you have to say no, right? Sacrifice for the greater good of everybody involved in our community as well.
Yeah, that's been the hardest challenge. And I think the message we've tried to tell our guys is be a great teammate. And that's on the court, that's off the court, that's in the community. And ultimately, you're gonna have these urges to do those things you're talking about. And then throw on top of the fact that we actually aren't allowed to work our guys out right now for safety reasons. So they're in their mind trying to find any way they can to get their hands on a ball. And, you know, at the end of the day, it's not safe right now for us. We haven't done everything possible. So to be able to challenge them to be a great teammate, and that means staying compliant and being flexible. And you may feel fine. You may feel like something is beneficial for you. But at the end of the day, when you're part of a team, you know, you got to put that organization ahead of yourself. And I think that's kind of been our message to our guys, not just our basketball team, but our Bethune-Cookman family, our Daytona Beach family, our state family. You know, their people back home, is you're a part of something much, much bigger, and you got to make decisions based on that group rather than yourself.
Most definitely. I've been I've learned the word no a lot, coach, in the last 5 months, because, yep. You know, having an 80-year-old dad, I worry about that, because my dad's 80 years old today. So he's not young, and he can attack, yep, older people. And I don't want to be selfish and go out, have a drink or whatever, and come back to my dad, and he's dead in a month, you know? And I'm like, wow, that's on me. So just that example of my father keeps me at bay, even though I do get stir crazy, but I got to protect my father and myself as well.
Absolutely. Absolutely. So same thing we're fighting down here is I share with you off air, I've got a daughter that's 1 month old. And so we quarantined for so long because I didn't want to take a risk. One, you don't know how it plays out in pregnant people. But also the fact is, if somehow I were to contract it, then I'm not able to go into the hospital for the birth of my second daughter. And now you're talking about all kinds of different things that could potentially happen. So we've tried to keep ourselves as safe as we can down here.
Now, coach, when the guys were at home during the shutdown, did you guys give them like a strength plan to kind of make sure they had some kind of semblance of shape now that they're coming back to you here in August? Because I know when you shut down, you might not have a hoop to get to, but doing like walking and running and a little exercise they maybe can do in their yards to kind of keep them somewhat in shape, not quite basketball shape, but some shape, so they're not having to start from scratch once you get back to them here right now. We can't work them out once safety measures are cleared.
Yeah, that's another great question. We've got a great strength and conditioning coach and program at Bethune-Cookman. And so obviously we followed the NCAA guidelines on what we were able to do, but we definitely had our returners and guys that were cleared. We had them a strength and conditioning program that they were able to do at home if they were able to access equipment safely, and they could do that without putting anybody in danger or at risk. But, you know, JR, I'll be honest with you. The thing that we did the most this offseason, we talked. We talked with our guys. We spent a lot of time on Zooms. We talked about social injustices. We talked about things that, you know, we could do to make a difference outside of basketball. And you know, sometimes we become so consumed with the sport that the season comes and wins and losses and this and this. And you really sometimes forget to connect with guys. And so, you know, really the last 3 months, we spent a lot of time understanding each person on our team and how we can help each other, but ultimately how we can help this nation as we go forward.
And coach, you bring up a great point, social justice issues. You know, I've taken start using my show once George Floyd happened to discuss these issues because I felt a need. And you know, my father grew up in the civil rights era. You know, my father grew up in Atlanta when it was segregated. We couldn't cross the railroad tracks by after dark. So talking to my father, I felt I needed to use my platform, which I got from 1.1 million listeners from Chattanooga to Macon. So I have to use this for good. So I felt like, you know, that burden to say, hey, I got to do this for everybody because people like me. You know, my dad was a barber, Coach Ritter. So from day one, I'm around different people all day long. So I don't care who I do with anybody because I'm used to my father. So I have to use the gift that I got as a young man for good with the radio show. So I feel like it's so important that we use sports to bring us together, because sports has been a unifying force in our society and in our country.
Yeah, you know, I think you're right on the money, and you know, I've got a unique perspective. You know, I'm a white guy at an HBCU coaching young black athletes, and you know, for me, it's been so eye opening, and working at HBCU has been educational for me to really understand. You know, you grow up playing basketball, you understand different perspectives, you understand, you know, diversity, but to really sit down and understand. You know, I'm not black. You know, I'm looking at you right now. You can see I will never be black. I don't know what it's like to stand in your shoes, but to be able to empathize and understand, man, what does systemic racism mean? What do these words and what does inequality really look like? You know, what is white privilege? For me to sit down and have these real conversations that I thought I knew so much about has been great to help, hopefully help put us on a platform to help continue to change some of these things.
And coach, you're in a perfect situation because, you know, you are a white guy with HBCU, because you can help other whites who don't understand, who won't listen to me, but hear from you, because sometimes you hear from who you come from. So I feel like it's great that you're in that position to help these young men. And how have those calls been with the players on Zoom, trying to educate them and educating you and educating each other? Because I feel like the more we talk about these uncomfortable things, that's how we really enact and go and get change we want for everybody involved.
Yeah, you know what? If it depends on the call. Some of them have been extremely emotional, sad, almost frustrated, angry, and then you have some uplifting moments. You see hope. You see potential change. But you know, as of you know, events as of recent as yesterday, the last couple of days, it kind of puts in perspective where we are as a country, and it's sad. You know, just to be point blank, I said in a meeting, our first team meeting last week, and one of my favorite guys, I won't use his name, but he's a big, big, big black dude with long hair and tattoos. And he standing up and he said, "Coach, why do people hate me? Because of the way I look." And I mean, you want to talk about melting someone's heart? I just hugged him and I said, "Man, I hope my daughters get to grow up to marry someone like you." And that's the stories we got to get out to the general public of, I think a lot of times white people in particular are scared of what they don't know, and they're scared of the unknown. Well, there's so many times there's not real genuine relationships between black and white people. They don't want to understand or empathize where someone's come from. And I think our university is and our team, we've done a great job of trying to understand and empathize and ultimately make change together. So, but those meetings are raw. They're hard sometimes. I mean, that's just the truth of it.
And coach, I'll tell you a quick story from personal perspective for me. From I didn't meet my first white kid to 94. I was 7 years old. So it took travel baseball for me to get introduced to white kids. I never met them. Yeah. I was 7 years old, coach. And so I know how sports can help us understand each other. And it could be an example for our country. Because when you play sports, it's not about JR, a black guy, Ryan, a white guy. We're trying to win together. It don't matter, you know. And then we can talk to each other. Then you learn about each other. Because you like them and you learn about them, then you understand, oh, wow, that's why you think that way. That's what molded you. So I feel like sports coach is such an opportunity to give our country an example of what we can be. When we are together and see everybody as a person, not white or black, we're just people with a common goal and a common stance and a kind of common mission to get the job done and win a game together and the game of life together as well.
Yeah, I think you're right on the money. It's about humanity at this point. I don't think it's it's about what's doing right. Everyone's talking politics and this and that. At the end of the day, we got some issues that they're humane, and we got to get those figured out. And I think, you know, for me speaking personally, we've got a great crop of young black men on our team that they can be a strong, powerful voice. And on top of that, you know, I do feel like I'm in a position of, you know, it's not the people who have been oppressed. It's not their job to fix the oppression. It's the people that are it's the oppressors that need to be the ones that got to make some changes. And, you know, I think I know we're up for the challenge. I know we're trying to figure that part out. And I think I've got some great people around me that, you know, can really help put this movement continue to help with the movement that's going on right now.
And coach, I know recruiting wise, do you feel like how you like the Zoom recruiting this season around? Cause I know usually you'd be on the road, trying to fine, great young men to bring in Bethune Cookman, but how was the recruiting via Zoom and doing campus visits via Zoom this during the COVID time here? Has that something you maybe keep in the future, or a little bit of mix of face-to-face and the Zoom mix to kind of expand your reach there?
Yeah, you know what? I'll tell you, actually, from recruiting standpoint, I don't know if it would happen every year, but it worked out great for us this year. We targeted three kids really, really hard. You know, we signed two early in the fall. Well, that was before all this happened. That was great. Two young kids, felt really good about them. But come Christmas time, we really targeted two guys during Christmas. And then when the season ended, we targeted a Division I transfer. And so there was three guys that we were just on every single day. And we built a heck of a relationship with them and the people around them. And, you know, when it came to decision time, and I'll just be transparent with you, we don't have the nicest facilities. We don't have some of the nicest bells and whistles on campus, but we got genuine people that want to make a difference. And so when it came to decision time, when you just make decisions based on relationships, you know, we got those three kids that we had put a lot of time and effort, where sometimes when you're younger, you may choose, a facility or something, a uniform that's maybe not as important long run. So for us, man, that it actually worked out great. We targeted the guys. We got them, got who we wanted, and we're fired up about them.
Oh, definitely. And also, Coach, I'm worried about you guys for this reason, because I've seen some of these guaranteed game contracts. I got a few of them in my email with that whole if you got fans, it's this number. If you don't have it, this number. HBCU schools have to raise money to pay for the non-revenue sports. They just have to. And how is that being, not knowing whether you're going to have a non-conference season, to raise money for the school, because it's so important to fund all the other sports and there's scholarships and those people in the university. So how has that been, trying to navigate that with the legal department and the other schools trying to make the schedule right for you guys?
Well, you know, that has been difficult, because there's just, you know, I think I looked at it the other day, out of the 350-plus Division I teams, only somewhere between 20 and 30 had released their schedule. So, you know, everyone's kind of fighting that issue right now. But, you know, we prepared like we were going to have a normal November, December non-conference. But I think as we're getting kind of closer to this mid-September date, I think there's some feelings that those may change. So, you know, right now we're prepared to play, and we've got our guarantee games lined up. But we've had great dialogue with our administration, with our legal department. If those things don't happen, how could we potentially raise more money? What would be the goal of our institution? But the other thing too is, if we don't have a non-conference season, well, now we're not spending as much money. So there's a lot of things to work out there. But, you know, at the end of the day, I said it right when we first started talking, that this virus is going to tell us what to do, whether we like it or not. And then, you know, we'll try to be as flexible and frugal as we can in terms of non-conference.
Well, Coach Ritter, I wish you all the best, buddy. I'm praying for you and your team to get out there and play some games, man. I know you guys need the resources for sure to make sure you guys are taken care of and not have to pinch pennies elsewhere, man. I love our chats, man. Good to see you. This soon. Good to see you, man.
Great to see you as well.
So we got this again soon, brother.
That sounds great, man. I appreciate you. I always enjoy being on the show.
Anytime, Coach. Thank you, buddy. Talk to you real soon, man.
All right. Thank you.
All right. It's Ryan Ritter here on the Bossman Show. We'll be right back.